So she's up to no good. You know, she's all of his tricks. And he's going, oh, okay. She said, okay, so here's what we're going to do. So she packs up her entire household, hires a camel caravan and a caravan leader, moves house together with the prince and these two women, two brides that he's got. And my friend Marisi, who is very, by the way, very observant Muslim herself, she said, now, the hostess, she treated this boy as her brother the whole time, her brother and sister. Now he's got these two brides who are given to him as brides, legitimately. And she said, as they're going back, the boy and his two brides are going off and, you know, sleeping and doing whatever. But she, the hostess, is staying up to pray every night because she's very religious. And she's a good woman. And so one day, as they approach, they get right to the gates of his family, Alice, whatever. And it's nighttime, and so the gates of the city have been closed, and you have to park outside the city until the gates open in the morning. Typical medieval situation, security. So they're parked out there, and the hostess, as is her custom, is staying up late to pray and meditate, and she notices that there's a very faint light. Something, someone, has come over the wall of the city and is going off toward the hills outside the city. She sees this light going on. So she goes along and she follows it. She realizes it's a woman, and as she goes along, she's following behind in the dark. And this woman goes off to a cave in the foothills, where there is a Barzangi. A Barzangi is a big demon, and demonic and supernatural and so on. And this woman is the lover of this Barzangi. And she comes in, who's really angry, and says, what's wrong with you? Why were you so late? I was ready to kill you. In fact, I'm still ready to kill you. What's going on? She says, listen, she says, it's not my fault. My husband is back, and his caravan is parked outside the city, and they're making preparations for him to come into the city in proper ceremonies, and nobody was going to sleep, and I couldn't get away, and it took a long time, that's why I'm late. It's okay. So then she sits there, and she, you know, combs his hair and de-louses him, which is something lovers do for one another, and you know, just cossets him and takes care of him and makes love to him and all that. And although my friend Marisi, by the way, was of the opinion that supernaturals and humans could not have sex. And there's a story, I need to know a lot about why that would be, but anyway, so she's, you know, there's hand going on, but anyway. And the hostess, the good woman, is observing all this from outside the cave, and she realizes that this is the kid's life, right? So so she, you know, stays. And then when the woman is about to leave, she runs into the ground and gets to a place where the path goes through two walls, and the walls are very close together between two wall fields. And she gets in there and she takes out a knife. This person's a little dark. And the bad wife comes along, she's running to get back before the light. And the hostess jumps out in front of her and says, where do you think you're going? What do you think you're doing? She says, oh, what are you doing? And she slices off the end of her nose. It's very comic. Look on your face, right? This was comic in context. It's no longer comic. But anyway, so she goes off, you know, and the hostess goes back to her husband, her friend, her brother, and assorted wives. And then in the morning, they make this big entry into the city, and they do all that, and they're being formally received, and the king and queen are very happy to have their son back, and he's got these two beautiful wives, and he's got the daily bride money, and so on, so you know, this is very impressive and good. And his wife doesn't show up to greet him, and the sister, the hostess, says, where's your wife? Where's the mother-in-law, actually? Says, where's your bride? How she's called by the mother-in-law. And the mother-in-law says, well, she didn't feel very good today. Well, that's okay, let her come. You know, I'm sort of a doctor, maybe I can figure out what's wrong with her. And so the wife comes in, and she's covering her face, and is supposed to be reading and stuff, and she's not happy at all. And the hostess, the sister, says,
what's the trouble? And she says, well, you know, I cut my face. And she says, let me see, maybe I can heal it. And she opens her veil and brings the piece of her nose out of her pocket and says, there's your nose. You were out there with that Barzangi last night. I know, I was there. And then she exposes this woman to her husband and her father-in-law and so on. And as is the usual case with such cases in Afghan fairy tales, they burn her in dog shit. And then the husband marries the girls that he's won officially, and also marries the hostess, who has put off allowing herself to be considered a fiancé until she gets to his house. And his father actually says, you've brought three wives. And so she's done a bunch of things that are very proper. She's very religious. She exposes a bad woman. She herself is a master trickster. But she doesn't do it in order to gratify herself or to compromise her family. And so in a weird way, I mean, this is why the story is so dark for Westerners. For one thing, nose cutting is going to happen in Afghanistan. And it's really a dreadful reality. A pathological reality, by the way, from an Afghan point of view, but nonetheless, it has happened. And so the story, which is, you know, the mayhem in the King's Court is pretty funny, but then my friend, because she's so concerned, she herself had been possessed. The backstory of this was, she had her own problems with demons, actually. And she'd been cured with a religious ceremony. And so her issues about how the supernaturals could really invade your life if you were a woman, they were quite real for her. And so the question of how this woman got tangled up with a supernatural, but that she was willing to be the lover of the supernatural. And in fact, one of the things that the sister hostess says to the bad wife is, you have this beautiful husband who loved you, who was trying to take care of you and give you everything you want, and you went off and got yourself a demon lover? You know, what's that? And so the story, although it's about women's tricks, it's also about virtue and sin in a very basic way, and disloyalty to husbands and things like that. So on the one hand, the woman the hostess, or the sister, is a very powerful woman, sort of taking matters into her own hands and tricking men and taking away, you know, robbing them of their authority and their control of the situation. She did it with the king and the vizier and so on. But she's doing it all sort of in with respect for and in service of this young guy's best interests and his own honor. So she exposes his bad wife, gets her killed. She ends up, actually, because his father considers her to be yet another fiancé, she ends up as the senior wife in this household. And she's obviously smarter than anybody else that's in the household, but she saw all this coming, and nobody else did, including the mother-in-law, who should have figured it out, but didn't. You know, so this whole dynamic of what's a trickster, what's a woman trickster for, sometimes they're just, you know, it's just comic mayhem. But a lot of times, in both these stories, I think you can see in the first one too, the guy was tricked into being very inappropriate and in being exploitative or trying to be exploitative, and she just jerked the rug out from under him. She let him think that he was going to get a freebie, that he was going to be able to corrupt somebody else's wife and still become a mullah, and she just, you know, she just jerked him around, jerked his chain. And the second story also, there's a certain amount of that going on. People get tricked because they deserve to be tricked, because either they're not taking proper responsibility or because they're in fact corrupt. So there's this serious side to these joke stories, but there's one that that's a little bit, I don't know, it's kind of ironic, but I'll probably talk to you more. Well, this is real short, so I'm going to run this by you. This one is a little, the deal is that, here's this guy, and he's a poor guy. He actually makes his living cutting sagebrush and taking it into the town and selling it for fuel, which is about the hardest living you can make. And it's really have no other resources. Anyway, so he's a brush cutter, basically. And one day, and he has a wife who's really not pleasant. She's nagging, picky, you know, critical, blah, blah, blah. Not a happy woman. Anyway, so he's out cutting brush one day, and he realized there's an old, he finds this old dry well. Something like he it's out there in the And he's got his little donkey and whatever. And he thinks, oh, no. And he goes back and he says to his wife, he said, you know what? I really ought to take you to visit your cousins. And she said, what cousins? And he says, you know, you got a whole set of cousins you don't know about, which is, this is possible in Afghanistan for various reasons. His families are very intricate and extended families are very extended. She says, no, you've got some cousins. I thought, you know, it'd be fun to go. It's time you had a visit. Let me take you to visit your cousins. And she says, ah, whatever, cousin. Ah. So he loads her onto the donkey and he takes her off into the desert to this passing this dry well. And he says, let me go get a drink of water. And he goes over and he looks in the well and says, wow, that's really interesting. I don't know what that is. What is it? What? You know? She says, what? He says, I don't know. I don't know what this is. So she goes over and she leans over and pushes in, dumps her in the well, and goes back to the city, done with this abusive wife. You know? So he goes back, but he thinks about it, and he's not at ease about this. And he thinks, you know, I really need to know what's going on and what happened. So he comes back, and he's approaching this well, and he hears this hollering coming out of the well. It's not her voice, it's some other voice. Help, get me out of here, help, help, I gotta get out. And he goes over, and he looks, he can't really see what's going on down there. He says, who are you? He says, and the voice says, I'm a snake. He says, you gotta get me out of here. There's the most awful woman in this well. She's driving me nuts. You gotta get me out of here. And the guy says, okay, all right, I'll do it, but I'll let down a rope. You can grab the rope. And I'll reel you up out of the well. But you have to make sure she doesn't fall. Make sure she doesn't get hold of her tail. You know, whip around so she can't get... Yeah, the snake says, I can do that. So he gets his rope, and he lets it in, and the snake grabs the rope, and quick hauls him out. And the snake says, okay, terrific. He says, I owe you one. Here's what I'm going to do. But only one, because as is well known, snakes and humans are enemies. But here's what I'll do for you, because I owe you. I'm going to go over the next town over where there's a king, who has no son, he has one daughter. And I'm going to wrap myself around the daughter. And I will not be removed until you come. And what you do is you wait until the king offers the daughter in marriage and to be heir to his throne to whoever can remove the snake. And once that offer goes down, then you come and, you know, I'll see you and I'll go away and you get the girl and you get the kingdom and you'll be, you know, because he saved my life and my son. Anyway, so the snake goes off and he does exactly what he says he's going to do. He wraps himself around the girl and he waits. And the king tries all kinds of things, you know, magic and force and whatever. And the snake just won't be removed and he's dangerous and nobody really wants to get near him. And the girl, you know. So anyway, so after a certain point, the father, the king, offers the girl in marriage and the inheritance of the throne to whoever can take the snake. So the thorn picker hears this and says, oh, terrific, okay, deal's going down. So he goes over and he presents himself and he says, you know, sire, I don't know, I don't know if I can do this, but I might be able to, I'll give it a try. And the king says, well, what the hell, everybody else has. So go ahead, he says, I'll have to do it alone. And nobody goes in with me, I have to do it by myself. So he goes in, watches the snake, and the snake says, okay, breathe in. And he unwraps himself from the girl and goes out and disappears. And everybody's delighted. They have a huge marriage, and the guy's now sitting pretty. He's heir to a throne. He's got a princess for a wife. He's in good shape. Everything's cool. And then in a few months, the next king over writes and says, you know, I've got a problem. The snake came along and wrapped himself around my daughter, and he won't leave. I wonder if your son-in-law could come and take care of it. I know he knows how to do these things. And the king asks his son-in-law, says, can you go help out a friend and then go deal with a snake? And he says, no. No two snakes are the same. I mean, some snakes you can deal with, and other snakes you can't. I don't think I can do this, really. I really don't. Because he's thinking, oh my God, it's the same snake. You know, the guy said, I'll kill you if you bother me again. We're even now. That's it.